Hello, internet world. My name is Michael, otherwise known as Maester Mike, as you can tell by the channel name. And it has been a long time since I've uploaded a video on this channel. It's been about 4.5 years. It's crazy to think how time flies when you're doing pretty much nothing in that entire time. That's not entirely true, but I'm not going to go into my whole life story. So why am I uploading a video now after all these years? Not sure how many people will really care since no one really watched my videos, but don't even need to beat myself up, but I just wanted to do something. I just wanted to put something out in the world, put out an opinion on a certain topic. Something that's been really, I've wanted to talk about for a long time, and I just never had the courage or the drive to really do it. What is that about? It's nothing about nothing specific. It's about Star Wars, really. Groundbreaking, I know. No one has ever thought about putting their opinions on Star Wars before, especially now. Yeah, I wanted to talk about Star Wars, especially with Episode 9, The Rise of Skywalker, coming out in December. And that's just almost a month away. So I wanted to talk about this series and what exactly it means to me, because I feel like I've had a bit of a rocky relationship with this series. Not that I hate the movies at all, but it's just a lot of things has happened with me in the series. Sorry that I keep adjusting this. I'm recording this on my phone. I don't have a really good stand. I'm just putting it on a Lego car to prop this up. Anyway, so Star Wars, what does it mean to me? Well, I grew up with watching the Star Wars. I started watching these movies at around the time the prequels came out, specifically around the time Attack of the Clones came out in 2002. Don't know why my parents didn't get me into Phantom Menace, although I think it may have been because I was too young at that time. But anyway, they came out at just the right time. I was experiencing a lot of new, great, exciting movies that really blew me away and just really excited my younger self. Like, the Harry Potter movies started to come out, the Spider-Man movies came out, didn't really care much for X-Men, and of course, the Lord of the Rings trilogy. That was my generation's Star Wars. But then again, with Star Wars, I had a lot to go in when those new movies came out back almost 20 years ago. Dang, that's a long time to think. So I had the original trilogy, there was The Phantom Menace was on DVD, and then we had Attack of the Clones just coming in theaters, so I had 5 movies to watch. And then I had Revenge of the Sith only 3 years later. And I remember thinking back then, oh, 3 years, I'm never going to live that long. And now that movie's almost 15 years old. Damn. Yeah, I grew up watching those at just the right time. Those movies really blew me away, alongside like the Lord of the Rings movies. They were such imaginative, exciting space adventures that, with great action, great imaginative worlds to go to, and just a lot of fun that I had. And I loved all 6 movies growing up, and I thought there was nothing wrong with them. But as the years went on, I kind of grew out of them for really 2 reasons. One, I wasn't really that hardcore of a fan. Like, I didn't read any of the Extended Universe books or comics. I didn't play many of the video games. I only play, like, Star Wars Bounty Hunter, which is still one of my all-time, not really an all-time classic, but it's still one of my most cherished memories in gaming. I play Star Wars Battlefront 1 specifically. I didn't play the second one all that much for some reason. The Lego Star Wars games, both the first, second, and the complete saga when that came out. And I didn't watch any of the Clone Wars TV shows. For some reason, when I saw that ad for the first show on Cartoon Network, I thought that was kind of dumb. Yeah, I was a kid back then, and I just thought, the cartoon, the Star Wars, this just looks weird. I don't know, I wasn't much of a Cartoon Network guy, and something about it, I just didn't really want to watch it, so I never did. Although I probably should, I hear they're really good by the fans. So I just wasn't very much of a... I don't think I was really ever as hardcore as I would have liked to think I was. And I also wasn't much on movies. I rarely watch movies. I prefer to play video games more. And then there was the case with the fans. While I never dealt with any of them directly, it came to my attention over the years that a lot of people really did not like the prequels. And there's nothing wrong with disliking movies. I like and dislike a lot of stuff myself, but I feel like people get a little overzealous with this franchise. Like, they just overhype the original trilogies, like they're God's gifts from heaven and they're untouchable masterpieces, while, well, the prequels just screwed everything up. They were terrible. They're abominations. They should never have been made. They ruined Star Wars. Like, that's just how it felt. Just, like, practically everything I was hearing, there was nonstop negativity with these movies, and it just... I loved all those movies growing up, and just all this negativity really rubbed me the wrong way, and I just kind of fell out of love with it. I didn't want to believe that my childhood was a lie, that I was liking a bad movie all this time. And so I just kind of kept my own opinions to myself, and I started to drift away from the series. And when Disney bought Star Wars and announced that they were making their own movies, I was really not interested in them. And even when they came out, they didn't really interest me. I was kind of done with Star Wars, and really, I just haven't watched the movies in a long time, so I can't really... I never really knew what I thought about them after all these years. So, what I'm trying to say is, with this new movie coming out in December, I wanted to rewatch all of them. I wanted to watch all the old movies back when The Force Awakens came out in 2015, but I only watched The Phantom Menace, and I never went further than that. And I'm pretty lazy, if you... But now, I think I'm gonna do that. I'm going to watch them all, and I'm just gonna put my own opinions out there, and just... And hopefully, if anyone cares about this, then good. I hope that you enjoy hearing my own opinions. I also I recorded this video multiple times, and I just never feel like it's good enough. I'm kind of a perfectionist in a way. So, yeah. Last night, I just watched for the first time in many years Star Wars A New Hope. And I really don't feel like I need to describe that movie, because who doesn't know what Star Wars is? Everyone knows that movie. The movie sets so many standards that I don't... It would be really redundant. But for, like, probably the two people who don't know it, which is... although it's probably growing because a lot of kids are sadly not into Star Wars anymore, which is very sad. I feel like I'll describe it. So you know Star Wars. It's the story of the evil Galactic Empire who controls many planets... controls most of the galaxy, has built this massive weapon called the Death Star, and the rebellion, helped by Princess Leia, has stolen the plans and has sent them away to a distant planet, where a young farmhand named Luke Skywalker finds it and discovers that he has a destiny as a Jedi. A Jedi. He's the next in a line of long warriors. I don't really know how to describe things. I'm not very good at this. Don't think I was ever, like, the biggest fan of... Damn it. Sorry. Yeah, he's a Jedi. He's a super-powered warrior who has a lightsaber, a laser sword, which is objectively the coolest weapon in film history. You cannot... There's no debate. Lightsabers are the coolest weapon in any film I've ever seen, and there's probably never going to be anything that tops it. So he finds the mysterious old hermit named Obi-Wan Kenobi, who takes him on a journey to get along with a smuggler Han Solo to get these plans to the rebellion, and then Luke learns that he has a destiny to help stop the Empire and return balance to the Force. It's a very classic story. I don't really need to describe it all. The reason I'm describing this is just, well, I'm trying to rediscover why I like these movies. And so, just watching it last night, it really took me back. It's just a very fun, very classic adventure that really was unlike anything else out there. It had such an incredible vision. To keep this video hopefully not going on too long, I wrote down some notes, so hopefully I can keep myself well paced. Just the whole thing, the story is very simple, very basic. It's the basic template for the hero's journey, but there's nothing wrong with that. And some people might think that the hero's journey is very cliche and very overdone, but really it's a very simple way of describing the human experience and how we grow, how we see the world, how we grow as people. Well, and it's something I find very fascinating about this movie is how even though this movie story has been done many times before 1977, this movie really set the template. Like, whenever people think of the basic hero's journey, they always think of Star Wars. That's, at least that's what I think. I think that's an accomplishment in and of itself. Whenever you think of that, Star Wars is the first thing that comes to your head. Yeah, even if it's simple, the story is just still very fun. It's... What I like about this movie is that it just has a very amazing vision. Like, its imagination is just incredible. Like, the designs of all the droids, all the ships, the worlds that they go to. Sure, it can be pretty basic and outdated with some of their costumes, but the fact that the vision that they had behind it was just so mind-boggling. It was just so incredible to witness. I really wish I was there in 1977 to see this movie for the first time. I was obviously not old. This came out many years before I was born, but I would just love to have a time machine to go back to see what that was like, just to see it on the big screen for the first time with so many other people. The story is very simple, but it doesn't need to be anything more than that. I just wanted to have a fun space adventure that to enjoy, to entertain audiences, both young and old. And it's done that for so many years, and it's truly remarkable. I just love the design of the world, the everything, and also I love the sound and the music. Everyone knows the music. John Williams' score is absolutely outstanding on all fronts. Although one thing I found very funny. This may sound funny to you, but watching this again, I'm shocked to learn that the Imperial March didn't actually start with this film. I thought it was in all of the original movies, but it apparently wasn't. I feel weird about that. It's such an iconic tune that it just feels empty without it. Oh well, it's in the next movie, so... And the sound design, the sound of... All the sounds of the guns, the ships, the lightsabers especially. I don't know if people give credit to the sound designer Ben Burtt. His sound is just absolutely spectacular. It just really makes you feel like you're in another world. And all the characters are very good. If I must be honest, I think I watched the prequels more than I did the original, I'm not very familiar with all the... It's been a while since I really dealt with how I feel about all the characters. But all the characters are very simple, but they work so well. All of them have simple, likable personalities, and that you want to root for them, you care for them, and you just want to see them succeed. They're all very likable characters. The droids, R2 and C-3PO, are very fun and endearing. I feel like R2 doesn't get too much screen time in this, where he doesn't do too much, but then again, I feel like the prequels made him a little bit OP in some things, but I like R2. He's always been one of my favorites. Luke, I feel, has been overhyped in, like, how whiny he was. A lot of people say he's very whiny and a little prissy, if that's the right word to say. I don't know. Well, I feel like there are a few moments of that in the film, but... Overall, I think Luke is a strong character. You feel for him, his wanting to break away from his family's farm. I mean, he's a good, noble character who's willing to risk his life to save Princess Leia, even though it may kill him. He's a good character. He's a good hero that you want to root for. Han is a very cool and cool badass. He plays by his own rules. He doesn't let anyone tell him what to do. He's just a cool smuggler. And also Chewbacca is very fun. I like that scene where he's playing that board game with the droids, and when Han tells them about Wookiee's personalities, and he's just putting his hands behind his head and just looking very smug. I like that. I wonder if people made a meme of that with him, like the Thug Life meme, you know? And Leia's also a very good character too. And she may be a damsel in distress, but she's very competent. She's very willing to take action. She's not afraid to fight herself. She's She's a good female character, and unlike what most of Hollywood thinks makes good female characters, which I'm not getting into that whole ordeal, she's very, very strong and a very likable character that you still root for. I also rediscovered just how good the villains are. The Empire is all very... Empire is all... I like how professional the Empire is. They're all very respectful. They're always very on top of everything. I like the leaders. Darth Vader is a... What needs to be said about Darth Vader? He's one of the greatest, if not the greatest, film villains of all time. I just like how serious and much of a threat he is. Like, his first entrance on the screen is just absolutely fantastic shot. That's a great establishing shot of a villain. And James Earl Jones just really kills it with his voice. He makes him so impressed, so intimidating. And I also like Grand Moff Tarkin. He's a very strong villain. Like, he's a good villain. Just like how he's... What's the word I'm looking for? He's very determined. He's very ruthless, but he's also very professional and very, very professional, very manipulative. He's a very smart man. He's a leader that you, even though he's a bad guy, he's one that I definitely would serve. What I would serve with honor, if that makes sense. And I also forgot about Obi-Wan. Obi-Wan is a very good guide for Luke. He's very mysterious, and he's very endearing. He's a good guy. Good guy. All the characters are very endearing. There's not much I can really say about the characters. They're all people you love. Just a classic. I would have loved to see what this movie was like back in the day when it was first released. There's some things that I will say about the movie that it does feel a little dated at some points. I'm looking at my notes right now. It does feel a little dated in some points. Like, I feel like some of the action is a little slow and not the most impressive things, especially in terms of like both the gunfights where most are very improbable, where most of the heroes often stand out in the open and they don't get behind cover, and the stormtroopers just keep missing. Like, that is a very blatant example of plot armor. One of the weirdest moments I remember is when the heroes are trying to get back to the Millennium Falcon on the Death Star, and they run into some stormtroopers. One of them says, "It's him! Blast him!" And Han just shoots them first, and they just go running. Like, how did that work? That's a very weird moment. And of course, we can't talk about hokey action without regards to, say, the lightsaber fight. I know it was the first fight that they ever had. They didn't really know how to properly do this, but it looks very, very silly and very comical now. I can give them the benefit of the doubt because it was the first lightsaber fight that they ever filmed, but it's still pretty cheesy. Although there was this one YouTuber that uploaded this really cool reenactment of the film to make it more in line with some of the modern movies. It's called, like, you can look it up on YouTube. It's like called Star Wars SC. Hold on a second, I'm gonna look it up right now. Not that. It's called Star Wars SC-38 Reimagined. That's a really awesome reenactment of it. So you should really look that up to see how that fight should go in a more modern take. I guess also some people say the acting can be a little cheesy. I don't know. I feel like the acting is good. Like, everyone really fits their roles perfectly. Although I feel like Mark Hamill does a few lines that are a little weird that makes him seem more whiny than he necessarily would be. And Carrie Fisher's accent seems to fluctuate throughout the film. It's stuff I can look past. And not that all the action is bad. The final attack on the Death Star is still a really exciting and seeing it. It's all very fun. It's a very good... Yeah, that's all of the base movie. The version I have that I prefer to watch is the 2004 DVD re-release of the films. I also have the the Blu-rays that were released before Disney purchased them in 2012. I'm kind of afraid to watch those because of some of the more controversial changes that they put into it. Yeah, you all know that the special editions added a lot of things that weren't really necessary. Like, of course, the infamous Han shot first, where they made Greedo shoot Han first before he kills him. That's another thing I feel like people get a little up in arms about. I feel like most of the changes aren't really that bad, but then again, I'm watching one of the... I don't know, I think the 2004 release isn't the worst offender of this, maybe. Or maybe I don't think it's that bad. I don't get myself too up in arms about Star Wars, really, so... Yeah, although some of the changes, like when they have some of those CGI animals and the CGI from the late 90s, and it looks very out of place and put up in front of a 1970s film, just looks really weird. They don't blend it very well. And then with regards to, say, the Greedo shooting first, personally, I think that scene is a little overblown. Like, I understand the pros and I understand why people don't like it. Like, it does take away from Han's rough edges where he's a scoundrel. He's a smuggler for a dangerous criminal, and he plays by his own rules, and he's willing to kill someone to get him, he's gonna kill someone to get himself out of a dangerous situation, and really, Greedo had it coming. He's a bad guy, too, so it kind of takes away from that edge. And also, it looks really silly because the way Greedo shoots at Han, it goes like 5 feet next to his face. His aim is about as bad as a stormtrooper's. And yeah, it is definitely unnecessary, but I feel like people overhype that scene a little too much. It's not really that bad. It's only just like a brief second that doesn't change anything. It doesn't change the outcome of the plot. I understand why people don't like it, but I think it's not as bad as everyone says it is. It's just a brief moment that didn't need to exist, but yeah, it's just definitely didn't need to exist, but it's not the worst thing I've ever seen in film. And then there's that scene where they added in where Han meets Jabba to get him away from his ship. He's trying to renegotiate his deals with him. I feel like that... Well, I understand why they put that in. That was a scene that was filmed for the original movie, and they just cut it for time. And also budget, because I wonder how long it took him to come up with the design for Jabba the Hutt. Yeah. It is neat to see that scene, because it's kind of like a director's cut where you put in cut scenes that were originally filmed for films, but never saw the light of day, but... I feel like it definitely didn't need to exist, because it kind of ruins the reveal of the Millennium Falcon just like 2 scenes later. And also, I would have liked to keep Jabba the Hutt, his identity, a mystery, because, like, he's this very dangerous criminal, and you would be interesting. You just don't know what he is or what he's like until Return of the Jedi shows him. Yeah, I feel like it definitely didn't need to exist. Overall, yeah, this is just an all-time classic movie and just one of the greats. I've watched it many times in the past, and I'll watch it many more times in the future. And I'm really impressed just like how well, like some of the stuff still gave me goosebumps. Like when Luke is looking up out into the horizon on the twin suns and the music plays, that gave me goosebumps genuinely. I do find it amazing how George Lucas was able to get this movie made. This was, by all accounts, this movie probably should have failed, because no studio would have accepted it. Sci-fi wasn't big, and it is kind of a silly movie when you really think about it, but it's such a legendary movie and just such a fun, imaginative world that's just can be watched anytime. It's just a timeless film. It really couldn't be done any other time than when it was in the late 70s. It can't even be done now, really, which is sad, but that's for another day. Watching this again, I really rediscovered my love for this film, and I had a blast watching it. I'm going to have a blast watching all the other movies. I really wonder what I'm going to think about those in the near future. So anyway, those are my thoughts. Star Wars A New Hope is just an all-time classic, and even though some people may not like the Star Wars, may think these movies are pretty cheesy and dumb and unoriginal, I think that they are all-time classics, and nothing can take away from the accomplishments that George Lucas and his team did back then when it was first made. So those are my thoughts. Hope you enjoyed it, and in the near future, I should be uploading some, should be watching all the other movies. Coming up next would be The Empire Strikes Back. So if you enjoy this, then just, this feels weird. Leave a like, comment, whatever. Do whatever you want. And I'll see you guys in the next video. Bye.